Hi, this is the video where we would discuss about tracking in dreams. This is the last topic of module 4, where we have two topics. One is split gate tracker and one is range clipped. Okay, so let us start with what is split gate tracker. This was actually a part of conical scanning block diagram where we saw a range gate. So briefly, I have already explained what is range gate. Let us see what is it in detail. Tracking in range. So usually in the earlier days of radar, this tracking of target in range was done manually by one operator who used to watch a scope. A scope is the display of the target. Okay. So he used to watch a scope and then he was positioning a hand wheel to maintain one marker on the display over the desired target point. Okay, so the setting of this hand wheel was the measure of the target range, and this was converted to electrical signal and then was applied to the processing part of the receiver. But then this manual tracking was not feasible and it had many limitations and it couldn't be used in missiles and all. So we went for split gate tracking. So in this technique, the automatic tracking in range is done. And it is based on a range gate. Okay, so let us go through what is written here. As target speeds increase, it is increasingly difficult for an operator to perform the increasing levels of efficiency over a sustained period of time. So that was what I was telling. So missiles and all. So in missiles and all, target speed is so much. So in that case, we can't rotate the hand wheel manually. Hence, we employed what is called as split range gate. So let us see what is this. We'll come back to this last line later. So this is the figure which I have got from this slide share. Okay. Now, here this is the echo signal, echo pulse which is received. This is the range gate which we have set at the receiving section. And this is the different signal. So in this, the two range gates, okay, here one is early gate and the one is late gate. These are generated and the video echo pulse which is shown here, this is A, B, C. Okay, so in A we have a video echo pulse which is received. Okay, the relative position of the two gates at particular instant is shown on this, and this is the different signal between these two. So this is the actual echo pulse which is received, this is the range gate set at the receiver, and this is the difference between these two. Okay, so these two signals are in the two gates. So you can see this is the midpoint of the echo pulse like this, and this is the middle of the range gate. So we see, are these two aligned or not? Okay, so here, if you come to this line, this much portion is within the early gate, rest of the portion is within the late gate. So this is the early gate signal. So this is exactly coinciding here, okay? So this much is under early gate and rest of the part is under late gate. So the signals in these two gates are integrated and then subtracted. Integrated, that is, it is joined together and then subtracted to produce the difference error signal as you see. The sign of this difference indicates the direction of the two range gates has to be, like, in which direction this range gate has to be moved in order to align with this echo. So our main aim is to align this with the echo pulse, correct? So that this target is in track, okay? So this amplitude of the difference here. So this difference we take, and the amplitude of this difference determines how far the pair of gates, this one, are from the center of the pulse, right? So this center of the pulse is sometimes called as centroid. So if the error signal is zero, that means the range gate are centered on the pulse and the position of the two gates give the target's range. The deviation of this pair of gates from the center of the two gates give the center of this, that is the centroid, increases the signal energy in one gate and decreases in the other as it deviates. So this might increase. So if this is moving further, this will further decrease, right? Like that. Okay, so in order to reduce the error signal, what do? We make sure these two are aligned. So the different signal will give you how different are these two aligned with each other. Okay, so this range gating, so you can see here, sign of the different signal indicates the direction the two gates have to be moved in order to have the pair straddle the echo pulse. That means exactly track the desired target. Okay. So this range gating allows a single target to be isolated. So it rejects all the unwanted signals and improves, ultimately it improves the SNR, the signal to noise ratio, by eliminating all the other noise from other ranges. So it exactly isolates only the desired target. Okay. So this is about split gate tracker, which is a part of tracking in range. So we have two topics inside tracking in range. One is split gate tracking, that is this one. Okay, so yeah, the same thing I've written here. Okay, so sign of the error signal determines the direction. It isolates one target, excluding all the other targets, and hence improves the SNR. Okay, and it eliminates noise from other range intervals. Now, apart from split gate tracking, we have something else called as range glint. Okay, so before that, let us see what is glint. Okay. So you wouldn't have heard this term, glint. This glint is actually called as angle noise. Okay, it affects usually all the tracking radars, especially those tracking radars which are at short range. Okay. So other names for this glint are, one is angle noise, which you can see here. Then it is also called as target noise, or angle fluctuations, or angle scintillations. Okay, but glint is the term which is commonly used. Okay, glint. So this glint occurs with complex targets. Okay, complex targets that have more than one scattering center. That is multiple scattering centers. So we have seen simple targets like sphere and cone sphere, right? So if you consider a simple target such as sphere, this sphere will not have a phenomenon of glint because it is not a complex target. Okay, because there is only one point of scattering in a scatterer such as a sphere. Okay. So a sphere is usually a single point scatterer. So these complex targets which have multiple scattering centers, like for example aircrafts or any other moving targets, they usually will cause glint, and this glint usually will degrade the tracking. So the echo from this single scatterer, for example sphere, it arrives at the radar antenna with uniform planar waveform. Okay, so you can see here it causes a distortion of the echo wavefront. So I'll just quickly move to one figure. This is the figure in your textbook. So if you consider a single scatterer, for example, like this. So here the echo from the single scatterer, okay, so that will arrive at the antenna. Imagining this is the antenna, okay. So so this echo from the single scatterer will arrive at the antenna, and then what it does is it will give us a uniform planar waveform, okay, like this. Okay, uniform planar waveform that has a tilt, and it will depend on the angle of arrival. Okay. So this is what is shown in this figure. So this is plane wave from one scatterer incident on the antenna. Okay. Now if target has multiple scatterers like this, okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay. So what happens is each of them will have a different angle. Okay. And then their individual echo signals here arrive at the antenna with a slightly different wave tilt. You can see here the tilt, wave tilt is different for each. Okay, so that is what is shown here. You can see plane waves from three scatterers incident on the antenna. The resultant aperture illumination is the vector sum of three plane waves here. Okay, so in this case, these tilted wave fronts which you see here add up vectorically, and then they give a composite wave front, okay, whose amplitude and phase are completely non-linear. So this glint from such a complex target is actually a distortion of the echo wave front. Okay, so this will result in a non-uniform wavefront. So, but we what we desire is uniform wavefront. Okay. Yeah. So this the ultimate result of all these is the error in the measurement of angle of arrival. Okay. You can see what is written here. So glint or angle noise is another name for glint. It's the fluctuation of error in the angle measurement caused by radar's energy reflecting from a complex target with multiple scattering centers. That is what we saw in that figure. So it distorts what echo wavefront. So this will result in a non-uniform wavefront from a complex target. But actually, radars are designed to have a planar echo wavefront. Okay. Hence, finally, we get a error in the measurement of angle of arrival. This measured angle of arrival can sometimes cause the bore site of the tracking antenna, okay, to be pointed outside the angular extent of the target. Correct. So this will cause a break in the track of the target. Okay. So these are the adverse effects of glint. So this, hence, it is a major source of error when making a angle measurements. So usually, complex targets with short range will have more effects of this glint. Okay. So this problem is with all the tracking radars with closed loop angle tracking, such as monopulse tracking, conical scan, and sequential array. All these three which we have learned yet. Right. So this is about angle glint. Now what we have to see is range glint. Okay. So let us assume a two scatterer model. So this is three scatterer. Okay. Let us assume a two scatterer model. Okay. So with separate scatterers in range rather than angle. Okay. So till now we were speaking about angle glint. This is range. Okay. So let us assume two scatterer model where the scatterers are separated in range, not in angle. So let us assume one scatterer is at a range R1, which is equal to C T1 by 2. And the other one is at R2, which is equal to C T2 by 2. Where C is the velocity of propagation. And T1 and T2 are the respective two-way time delays of the to the two scatterers. Okay. Two-way time delays. Okay. It's not one way, two-way time delays to the two scatterers. So these two scatterers are assumed to be unresolved. Okay, so they are generating some non-uniformity, right? So this error delta TR, sorry, this R is suffix, okay? So this error that is delta TR due to this range glint in the measurement of the time delay relative to the center of the two scatterers is given with this expression. Okay, we are not going in detail about this expression. So this is delta TR, which is the error due to the range glint, the measurement of the time delay. Okay, so this delta TR is delta T by 2, which is obtained as this. Okay, so here delta T is nothing but 2 into R2 minus R1 by C. Okay, so I'll just take it this side. So this is 2R1 by C. This is 2R2 by C. 2 into R2 minus R1 by C is nothing but delta T. That is T2 minus T1. So this is the time extent of the target, delta T. Okay, fine. And this A is the ratio of the amplitudes of the signal from the two scatterers, usually which is less than or equal to 1. Okay, and F0 here is the radar carrier frequency. Okay, so this is range glint. So the range measurement error can be larger than the extent of the target. Okay, so this is a serious problem. So if this range glint is a problem, so the best approach to reduce this range glint, if we have sufficient bandwidth available, the best approach is to employ high range resolution. Okay, so if the individual scatterers of the target can result in range, then both angle and range glint will not be a problem. Okay. So tracking in range is actually usually more accurate than tracking in angle. Okay. So if there are any effects of the range glint, that is of less concern than the errors in angle. Okay. So that is all about range glint. Thank you.